And there it is, the view outside today. It is a gloomy day. It is misty, murky, wet. We've had a lot of rain over the past 12 hours. And I suppose the best place to be today is in the studio, which is where I am right now. Hello, everyone. Welcome. Here we go again. Yes, it's another English Addict coming to you live and direct from the birthplace of the English language, which is England. Hi, everybody. This is Mr. Duncan in England. How are you today? Are you okay? I hope so. Are you happy? I really hope you are feeling happy today. Here we go. We are back again once more. And it's a special day today. Do you know why? Very special. Well, first of all, we're here together. That is always a special thing, to be honest. And of course, we have a brand new month as well. A new month has arrived. Hello to the new month. Here we go. Say goodbye to four and say hello to five. It is the 1st of May, and I hope you are having a good May day so far. We will be talking about the reason why people get very excited by May Day a little bit later on. But first of all, I should introduce myself. My name is Duncan. I'm Duncan. That's my name. What's yours? And I like English. You might say that I am one of those up there. I am an English addict. I like English so much. I am hoping one day I will be able to marry all of the words. I want to walk down the aisle of the church holding on to my dictionary, and we can spend forever together, and I can go through all of those lovely words every night. We can play around as I flick all of those pages of the dictionary, and I learn maybe a new word, maybe a word that I've never heard of before. It is possible. You might not believe this, but it is possible, even if you are a native English speaker, to learn an English word that you've never heard of before. And it happens all the time. I often discover words that I did not know existed in the past. It's true. A good example, I suppose, is furlough. Furlough. So if you are allowed to take time off work, if it has been approved, and maybe you will still receive some sort of payment, we call that furlough. A very interesting word. Before the pandemic, I did not know what furlough was. I had never heard the word furlough before. But then the pandemic came along and everyone started talking about furlough schemes. Furlough. I'm not working at the moment. I am on furlough. And then suddenly I realized that I was learning a new word, and a word I had never heard before. So there you go. Even though I speak English and I've been learning English from my childhood, there are still words that I don't know. Still words that are out there like distant planets waiting to be discovered. Hopefully today we will discover some new words, and maybe they will be new words for you. Yes, we have made it to the end of another week and also another weekend. However, as I've already mentioned, it is also the start of a brand new month. Welcome to Sunday! Beep, beep, beep. Welcome to Sunday. Welcome to a new month. Welcome, everyone, wherever you are in the world. It's a super duper day today. And we have a lot to talk about today. Today we are talking about life. If you are young, you have your life ahead of you. If you are old, like me, you have quite a lot of your life behind you. So today we are looking at the best time of life. So you don't have to be older to answer this question. You can be any age. So your perception, your own opinion of when the best time of life is. So even if you are still in your 20s, if you are very young maybe, you can still answer the question because it is about opinion. So I suppose if I had to answer the question myself, I would say the best time of my life was probably in my 30s and 40s. So I think, so again, my own experience, this is what I am basing this opinion on, my own opinion. I think the best time of my life was my 30s and 40s. I think it was a super time. It was a time where you can explore the world, find out what it's all about, hopefully learn some useful lessons as you do those things. So that's what I think anyway. My great period would be my 30s and 40s. However, I am still having a pretty good time now, to be honest. So things are okay now. It's still exciting. There are still new things to explore, still new things to find out about. As I mentioned a few moments ago, there are still English words that I've never seen before or experienced. So there is always something new to discover in this crazy thing called life. But as far as I'm concerned, I think I would have to say that my 30s and 40s were probably, for me, the best time of my life. When you are young, you don't know so much. And then as you slowly get older and hopefully you gain experience, you experience life, the world, things around you. And I suppose you might say that it makes you into the person you eventually become. A lot of people believe that you have the life and the face that you deserve by the time you are 50, apparently. So I don't know what that means about me. I don't know what that means about my particular life or even yours. But when I look in the mirror sometimes, I think, has my life been good? And then I look at my reflection and I can see some of the lines on my face and I think, well, I suppose those lines are the experiences that I've had, the moments of happiness and also the moments of unhappiness as well. So what about you? When was the best time of your life, or when is the best time in your experience and your opinion? We will be talking about that in a few moments. Can I also say hello? Hello to the live chat. It would not be a live chat without you there. Thank you very much for sitting down calmly. Maybe you have a cup of tea in your hand, or maybe a cup of coffee. Maybe you are having your breakfast or your lunch, or maybe you are taking a break from your work. Can I say hello and thanks for joining me? Hello also to Vitas. Oh, Vitas. Beatrice. Also, Luis Mendez. And Tomek. Maria. MD Milan. Gluten, Paolo, Zizika, and also Florence, wow, and Trong Vio. All of you arrived at around about the same time, at exactly 2 o'clock UK time. So can I say congratulations to all of you? You can see my reaction. This is genuine. This is a genuine reaction to all of you arriving at the same time. Not only that, I was feeling quite pleased with myself today because I actually arrived on time, which makes a nice change when you think about it. Nice to see you all here. Also, hello to Dea Amajidi. Hello to you as well. We also have Alessandra. Nice to see you here. Christina is also here on the live chat. Hello to everyone, and thank you for joining me today. We are also looking at another subject. You might say that the subject we are going to talk about today, when Mr. Steve arrives, is a little bit controversial, perhaps. Maybe it is a subject that some people get very hot under the collar over. If you get hot under the collar, it quite often means you become frustrated or excited over that particular thing. You become hot under the collar. We are looking at words in English that are gender specific. They are related to gender. You might also be surprised to find out that there are more words using man than there are words that use woman. So that is something we are going to look at as well today. As I mentioned, we have Mr. Steve here as well. Steve, we are both feeling rather happy this weekend. First of all, we have an extra day's holiday, so tomorrow is a public holiday. So Steve is very excited because he doesn't have to go to work tomorrow. He's pleased about that, let's just say. And I'm also pleased because I can have a nice rest and relax with Mr. Steve as well. So that's what we're doing tomorrow. We have a nice long weekend. Another reason why we're happy is, well, first of all, we said goodbye to April. I'm really pleased about that, to be honest, because let's face it, April was a bit stinky. It was a horrible month because we both got COVID. Steve got coronavirus first, and then I caught it from him. And so we've both had COVID during April. So we are quite relieved. We are happy for two reasons. One, we can say goodbye to April. And the other reason is we feel much better. We went for a walk yesterday, but I did notice when I first started walking yesterday, I was out of breath. I was tired suddenly. My heart was pounding away like a drum, but I was okay after a short time. So I've noticed this. If you don't have any exercise for a few days, and I didn't because I was ill in bed, you find sometimes your body takes a while to adjust to being active again. So it was a strange moment of time yesterday when I realized that I was slightly unhealthy, maybe because I've been unwell for the past 2 weeks. Hello, Rosa. Hello, Willianne. Hello also to Marcia. Hello, Marcia. Nice to see you here as well. Hello to MY. I don't know where you are, but I'm intrigued to find out. I would like to know where you are. So when is the best time of your life? When is the best period of your life? I have my own theories of when the best time is. You might not agree, but that's the reason why sharing our experiences is such a good thing, because we can agree on some things and disagree on others, I suppose. Hello, Gulu, who says, Mr. Duncan, you are not old. Beyond Awake. Hello, Beyond Awake. Nice to see you back as well. You are as old as you feel. Well, I suppose that's true. I sometimes find that the way I feel changes depending on how I feel in the morning when I wake up. So sometimes I have aches and pains. By the way, Steve is complaining at the moment because he has some aches and pains. And I keep saying to him, Mr. Steve, you are not young anymore. You might get the occasional ache and pain, especially in the morning. Hello, Beatrice. I totally agree with you, Mr. Duncan. My best time was in my 30s and 40s, but I am living another best period in my life right now. That is good. Yes. I suppose from my point of view, what I'm actually talking about is generally. So I always think of my teenage years as being difficult. I struggled a lot during my teenage years for various reasons that I won't go into here today. And then my 20s came along, and I suppose my 20s were learning. I was still learning. I was still adjusting. I was still learning about myself and the world around me. And then my 30s, I suppose when my 30s came, I felt as if I could experience life. I could experience the things that maybe I wanted to actually experience for myself. Things that you read about, things that you see, and then you think, ooh, I would like to try that myself. I like the look of that. Maybe a country, maybe a place, maybe something you want to try for yourself. So your 30s, I always think when you are in your 30s, it is life in front of you, ready to be explored and experienced. I think so anyway. Hello to Nelly. Hello, Nelly, the oldest woman in the world. Is 118 years old. So unfortunately, Mr. Steve's mother still has a long way to go. 118 years old, and she lives in my city. So in where you live, in the south of France. So the oldest person in the world, or should I say the oldest woman in the world, is 118 years old. It would be interesting to find what that lady thinks about her life. Maybe we could ask that same question. What was the best time of your life, 118-year-old lady? I wish I knew what her name was. What's her name? Does she have a name? Can she remember it? I hope so. Hello, Michael. Michael Labus says, the best time of my life was in my 30s. Yes, I think so. I think a lot of people who are over 30 will probably say that the best time of their life was their 30s. Their 30s, because it is the time when you have experience, freedom, health, everything. Everything is level. And quite often your way of viewing the world around you is also quite clear as well, if you are lucky. If you are lucky. Yes, I think you are right. The 30s, your 30s. When you are 31, it feels as if you can actually do a little bit of living. And that's what I did. Hello also to Trong, Trong Vio. When I was a child, the best time in my life was, oh, I see, when I was a child is the best time of my life because I did not have to think about things. I did not have pain and I did not have worry. Yes, I suppose as you get older, you often think of your childhood more and more. But the thing I've noticed is quite often you will view your childhood through something I like to call rose-coloured glasses. So everything seems better than it actually was. So your perception of your childhood sometimes alters or changes. Maybe it becomes a little bit too positive. Maybe there were bad things that happened in your childhood that you've forgotten about. So sometimes that happens, you see. But I think, yes, for many people, childhood is a time of learning, growing, and playing, I suppose. Hello, Beatrice. Oh, I see. Yes, apparently the oldest woman in the world was Japanese, but then sadly she died, and now the oldest woman in the world is 118. So when Mr. Steve is talking to his mother tonight, he will have to say, look, you are a very long way from being the oldest woman in the world. You have to hang on a bit longer, please. Hello also, Maria Giovanna La Rosa. Nice to see you here as well. May Day has arrived. Yes, a lot of people think of May Day. May Day is a special day around the world for various reasons. It is May Day or Labor Day. It is a tradition that is often celebrated as spring arrives. So you might say that it is a traditional spring festival. It is also one commemorating workers. So depending on where you are in the world will probably depend on how you are celebrating this particular day. So quite often we have festivals, we have celebrations here in the UK. We have traditional celebrations as May arrives, because we often think of springtime and then summer is also approaching. So there are lots of festivals that normally take place. You might also have this particular activity, the Maypole Dance. This is something that is often done in English villages at this time of year, and traditionally you would have young maidens would dance around a large pole. I suppose we don't have to use our imagination too much to work out what that symbolizes. And yes, you are right, that's exactly what it symbolizes. It is a fertility festival. So the young maidens will dance around the large pole. Do I have to say any more than that? I think that's it really, isn't it? I think you know what I'm saying. So it's all about fertility, everything coming to life. We are wishing for a good harvest. So it's all of those things. And of course, as I said, people also commemorate those who are working, who have fought for workers' rights in the past. And there have been many people who have done that. We often think of rights and freedom as things that are given, but they are rarely given. They are rarely handed over freely. And if you look back through history, you will find that all of the things that we take for granted now, all of the freedom that we have, quite often has been taken through struggle or through conflict. So you often find that things that appear to have been given, like freedom, quite often hasn't been given freely. Quite often it has been fought for. So you might think of workers' rights as being something that has been fought for. It was never given. It was never handed to them. So there we go. So that's what's happening today. We have Mr. Steve coming up in a few moments. When was the best time of your life? We can carry on talking about that as well. Steve will be with us. We will have a short break whilst Steve prepares himself I think he needs his diaper changing, and then he will be with us live as live can be right after this, which is an excerpt from one of my full English lessons. This is Full English 36. And then after, yes, he is here live in the studio on this super duper May Day. Mr. Steve will be here.
Ahoy hoy! What a strange thing to say at the start of a new lesson. Well, it might seem strange now, but did you know that after Alexander Graham Bell invented the telephone, he thought that saying hello when answering a call would be confusing for the person at the other end of the line. So he suggested that people say ahoy hoy instead. That's a fact, and you can put that in your hat. Hi everyone, and welcome to another Full English lesson. Yes, we are all here together again to share our love of the English language. So without any more... hanging on the line, let's get on with today's Full English lesson, which will start around about... now! A man goes to the doctor. He says, "Doctor, doctor, I feel like a pair of curtains." And the doctor replies, "Oh, pull yourself together." There is nothing I enjoy more than having a good laugh. If I find something funny, then it is hard for me to hide my amusement. Something funny amuses me. The funny thing is amusing. They say that laughter is the best medicine when you are feeling sad, and this might very well be true. However, saying something you find funny can sometimes get you into trouble. Sometimes making a joke about something can get you into hot water. There are many words relating to jokes and humour, such as comedy, which defines anything done for the amusement of others. A comedy act will perform something funny. Then there is clowning, or clowning around, which describes the act of not being serious. You are playing for laughs. You are clowning around. A carnival performer who acts in a ludicrous way for the amusement of an audience is a clown. We might describe a person who always acts the fool and never takes anything seriously as a clown. He always disrupts my lessons by acting the clown in class. We wasted a whole day clowning around with party balloons. Another word relating to humour is comedian, which is a person who tells amusing stories and jokes for a living. Then there is a comedienne, which is the term used to describe a female comedian. Although these days the word comedian is often used for both male and female comedy performers. A joke is a story with a humorous ending. The funny part of a joke is called the punchline or tagline. It is the climax of a joke or story. Another word that can be used to mean joke is gag. You tell a gag. You stand up and tell gags. A person who stands on a stage to tell jokes is called a stand-up comedian. They perform stand-up comedy. Their act is called a routine, which is a carefully rehearsed comedy performance. I saw one of the funniest comedy routines ever last night. I'm off to the comedy club tonight to see some new routines. If a group of people are performing a short funny play with a humorous story, then this is called a sketch. If someone is making a joke about a famous person or a well-known organisation, such as the government, then this is called satire, lampooning, spoofing, or sending up. A well-known celebrity or politician might be on the receiving end of a satirical sketch. the comedy performers are poking fun at the well-known person. To perform a humorous version of something serious can be described as a spoof. The movie This Is Spinal Tap is a spoof of the rock music industry. Then there is tongue-in-cheek humour, which makes fun of something in an ironic or insincere way. The thing being watched seems to have a serious tone, but it is not to be taken seriously. It is all done tongue-in-cheek. It would be fair to say that a joke which is funny to one person might not be funny to another. It might even be considered by some to be offensive. Each one of us has a slightly different feeling when we hear the same joke being performed. It all depends on what is being said and who is saying it. I can't believe you find Doug Stanhope funny. He is so rude. I don't understand why you dislike Doug Stanhope so much. He is hilarious. This is what we call our sense of humour. Some people will laugh at anything, whilst others will hardly ever laugh at all. It is yet another fascinating piece of the human emotion puzzle that makes us all the individuals we are. Do you have a good sense of humour? What makes you laugh? Do you know any good jokes? One of the most frustrating parts of living in this modern age must be the amount of information we are expected to read and absorb. To make matters worse, sometimes this information is written in such a confusing way that it becomes unintelligible. The words used are incomprehensible and perplexing. It is hard to grasp what is being explained to you. We call this type of information jargon. The word jargon means a specific type of terminology that relates to a certain subject. Some of the words used in one area of a particular subject can be described as jargon. I don't understand this letter I received from my lawyer. It's full of legal jargon. Don't try to blind me with your science jargon. Just give it to me straight. To follow a list of instructions that have been given to you might force you to learn some of the jargon. To master how to operate this device, I will need to learn some computer jargon. The jargon being read isn't fully understood. It is too esoteric. It relates to a specialist field. The thing being read is unintelligible. It is all gobbledygook. It makes no sense. As far as you can tell, it's just a load of mumbo jumbo. A letter from your lawyer or doctor might contain lots of jargon. An advanced textbook on a particular subject might contain lots of confusing jargon. The operating instructions of a piece of technology will almost certainly contain lots of lovely technical jargon. We will often ask for the information to be simplified and explained in plain English that we can easily understand. Just give it to me straight, without all the jargon. Some might say that the one good thing about jargon is that it forces us to learn new things and absorb new information. This might be true. However, in this fast-paced age of new information appearing almost on a daily basis, it might be time to lessen the technical terms, cut down on the gobbledygook, lay off the confusing terminology, and ease off the use of jargon. Please? We are back, and I hope you enjoyed that. That was an excerpt from one of my full English lessons, and there are lots of full English lessons and all sorts of things on my YouTube channel. Very interesting.
Oh, look at that. Whoa. What are you watching, Steve? Oh, that's...
Mr. Duncan.
What? Oh, it's okay. We were not watching dirty movies.
Oh, no.
We were definitely not watching anything like that. It was all clean. Very, very clean. That's all I can say. Hello, Mr. Steve.
Hello, Mr. Duncan. Hello, wonderful viewers from across the globe and across the universe. I'm sure somebody's watching us right now.
Yes.
In another part of the galaxy.
I wouldn't be surprised. Maybe 1,000 years from now, after the Earth has disappeared, it's just a piece of coal floating in space. There will be signals flying through the universe, and it will be us. There might be some intelligent life on other planets, and we might be the first thing that they see.
Well, Mr. Duncan, that was interesting. You should say that because
The
Hubble spaceship, Hubble telescope, has discovered this, the furthest galaxy at something like 13 billion light years away.
That's a long way.
That's a long way. So, you know, one day we will be... I don't know, are we being broadcast? You know, is it going that way, Mr. Duncan, through radio waves?
Well, yes,
we need to be broadcast via radio waves.
No, because we're going out in all different ways. Some people are broadcasting us. There are mobile phones that are picking up the signals. All of these things are flying around, and eventually they might end up on Uranus. You never know.
You're back to the porn again, Mr. Duncan.
You know, well, I wasn't going to use that word, but there you go.
But if anyone's been watching the news, probably people don't know.
No, everyone knows.
Oh, do they?
Anyway, I'm not going to dwell on that, Steve, for various reasons. That was just a light joke, you see. Okay, that's demolished that. But apparently we're going to Uranus. Have you heard this? Apparently we're sending a big probe, and it's going to go all the way to Uranus. It's going to take lots of photographs. It's true.
The doctor does that to most men when they're around 40.
No, I'm not.
Sends a probe at Uranus.
No, I'm not joking.
Well, I was joking.
Oh, okay. But I am. Yes, apparently about 10 years from now, they're going to send a probe. It's going to explore all of the moons of Uranus.
Why not?
So you might have lots of little things floating around Uranus. And they're going to take some very close photographs of them. But before you get too excited, apparently it's not going to reach there until around 2044. So we do have a little wait.
2044, I'll be well into my 80s then. Mm. 2044, blimey, I should be... Well, I won't say how old I am, but I should be in my 80s.
But will you be the oldest person on the planet? Because we were talking about this a few moments ago. We're talking about life today, the best time of your life. So you don't have to be older to answer this question. Maybe from your own perception of life, from looking at other people around you. So we were talking earlier about when is the best time or the best period of your life. And I think it's an interesting question, because a lot of people might have different opinions. So what are the best years of your life? So let's ask Mr. Steve. I did mention mine earlier. I think my 30s and my 40s were the best period of my life. So that's looking back, because those years have already gone, you see. I've spent them. They will not be refunded. I will not get a second chance. So what about you, Mr. Steve? The best years of your life?
Well, I'm hoping they're yet to come.
Oh, dear.
I'm hoping the best years of my life are yet to come.
Okay.
Well, but Christina said, interestingly enough, hello, Christina, that she thinks that the best days of her life are now. I think it was Christina that said that.
Okay.
So, yes, I mean, yeah, I mean, you can... The thing is, if you talk about your past years as being the best years, then, you know, what have you got to look forward to?
Well, no, but it's just from looking back at all of the years that you've had. So from your 20s, your 30s, your 40s, And so there will be a best decade. So I think my 30s and 40s. So I'm not saying the rest of my life is going to be really crappy. I'm just saying, looking back, there is a perception quite often of having a better experience of life because of certain situations or certain reasons.
You've got nice memories.
Yes.
It was Magdalena that said that now was the best period of their life.
Mm.
So, yes, but I do. I've got this. I'm hoping that the best years of my life are yet to come.
Yes, well.
That I'm going to do something and achieve greater things. Yeah. In the future, but age is against me now.
Yes, well, this is it. You might be hoping, and then suddenly you're dead.
Well, it's no good hoping. You've got to make plans,
yes,
haven't you?
Yes.
If you want to achieve something in life, then it's no good wishing and hoping.
No.
You've got to actually make some concrete plans.
Yes. And this brings me back to what I said earlier. I think when you are in your 30s, you are more likely to do things that are adventurous or maybe things that might frighten you. So you are more prepared to take risks when you are younger. And I think in your 30s, that is the period of time when you are more likely to do things that might be risky or dangerous. You seem fearless. You seem to have no worry about the consequences of things. Because you've learnt a lot about life, you've learnt a lot about yourself, and now you want to go out and explore the world and learn these things for yourself, experience these things. So I think your 30s are the best.
Well, Lewis agrees with you. He says the best years were between 25 and 40, but it's always marvellous to be alive.
Yes. So that's
such a positive attitude.
It is always good to be alive.
It's always good to be alive. But yes, I do like to think that I've got things that I'm going to achieve in the future, you know, like owning a Ford Mustang, for example.
Okay.
That will give me pleasure in the future and will give me a sense of achievement, because I think that's what gives you satisfaction looking back, is what you've achieved in life. Have you made the most of your talents, your abilities, things like that? You know, I don't want to feel as though I've wasted my time or my life. That would I think cause me distress in later years if I couldn't do anything and I looked back and thought, well, you know, regret.
Yes.
Regret is probably what you want to try and avoid.
Yes, you might end up regretting something, but you have to make sure the list of regrets is short. So this is what I see. So this is how I see it, Steve. We have your 20s. Your 20s, I always see that as your learning period, because you're still adjusting. You're finding out about yourself. Your teenage years are sort of everything. It's all coming at you at the same time. But in your 20s, I think you can start to see the reality, the real picture. So you are learning about yourself and life in general. And then in your 30s, I see this is the living period, which sounds strange. So I'm not saying that you are alive during your 30s. What I'm saying is you are getting a lot of experience of other things. And that's what we did. So I always think of our 30s, Steve, as us traveling to different countries and around the world in finding out about other things. So we were quite adventurous, I think, in our 30s. We did things that we would never do now. Legal, of course, they're legal things, not illegal, legal. But things that we wouldn't do now, just jumping on an aeroplane and going to a country that we've never been to before, just without even thinking about it. But now we would be so worried. Oh, it's so long. Oh, it's such a long way. I have to sit on the plane with all of those people. And then your 40s come along, and that is your working period. So by then, you've established yourself. You've got a job. You've normally got some sort of stability in your career. So that's your working period. I will ask you what you think of this in a moment, don't worry. In your 50s, is you're establishing.
Is this what this is what you think, is it?
Well, yes. Fine. Well, this is not. Well,
this is
yes.
your opinion.
Yes, just from my own experience. So you're establishing time. So you're establishing yourself. Maybe you are moving to a new house. Maybe it's the house that you are going to spend the rest of your life at. So you are setting down your roots when you are in your 50s. And then, of course, after that, I haven't reached that one yet. I am not in my 60s. But I would say that your 60s is your time for enjoying life. So I think that is how it works from my own point of view. So what do you think? And what do you think?
Well, it's very different for people, couples maybe, who are wanting to build a family. That would skew things slightly. But yes, each decade, you can divide it up into decades. And establishing a career, and then but then of course life events come along which can throw you off course.
Yes.
But you know, I'm not seeing my 60s as a period to I think you've got to try and enjoy life all the way through. I mean, so I know what you're saying. You sort of you've worked all your life.
Yes.
And then you've maybe saved up for your retirement, and then you retire. And then you can enjoy your retirement period,
yes.
which is usually sort of 60, 65 onwards. So, yes, you should, in theory, build up enough capital so that you can enjoy your retirement without having to worry about bills and where the next meal is coming from.
Yeah.
Which is why it's always important, if you can, I think, to save a percentage of your wages. Your entire
but
life.
I'm not really talking about money anyway. Money is in those things anyway. So,
well, I was just making a point about your retirement. You need enough money to be able to, because if you're not working anymore, then if you haven't got an income coming in, then it's going to be a very hard life in retirement if you haven't built up some savings or a pension or something along the way. And of course, moving forward, it's probably going to be very difficult for people if you're going to rely on state pensions, which are probably falling in real terms.
Okay, Steve.
So, yes.
This has nothing to do with the subject.
I think your teenage years is when you have fun and enjoy yourself. Then you get more responsibilities, you get older, job, family, that sort of thing. I mean, if you're in your 30s, but you're in your 20s and 30s and you've got children... A lot of people, you know, have children in their 30s. They're building a family. So I'd add that in.
Yes, but that would be the thing that they are doing. That's the exploration of their life in their 30s, is raising a family, finding out all of those ways of doing it. And of course, they can still have adventure. Families can still have adventures, I'm pretty sure. I'm sure if you are in your 30s and you are raising your family, you can still have adventure and excitement, I think so. So it's not necessarily just about people who are single or don't have children. I think everyone has that same opportunity, or maybe that same outlook, either looking forward or looking back. So we are looking back now. I do find it's a bit like driving along the road, isn't it, Steve? I find more of my time now looking in the rear view mirror.
sounds a bit negative, Mr. Duncan.
But you do. But I think you do. You reflect on your life because there's a road behind you. But
yes.
then also you have to remember to keep your hand on the steering wheel and look ahead at the road in front of you as well. So I think that's the secret. It really is.
Yes, and as Christina's pointed out, of course, you never know. There are lots of people who have, for various reasons, have to start their lives all over again. So this sort of pattern that you think what happens in your 20s, 30s, 40s can be completely disrupted by, you know, events.
Yes, the unexpected.
The unexpected event, which means you might have to start all over again. You know, you might lose your job, your house. There could be a conflict in your country. You know, we don't know what's going on at the moment. Anything can happen, and you might have to literally go. So you might lose everything and have to start again. I mean, this is
your partner might leave you, might run off.
Yeah, might die, anything could happen.
Yeah, so there are unexpected things. And I suppose also, in that respect, looking at those periods of your life, I think it's easier to cope with those things when you are younger than when you are older. Because I think you tend to hold on to these things more and more as you get older.
I think you definitely take less risks as you get older. I know I do. I remember when I was in my 20s, I wouldn't think twice about going out and buying a new car, borrowing some money to get it. And then, you know, I'd change it in 6 months or another year, get another one, borrow some more money, you know. Or I wouldn't think twice about changing my job. Oh, I don't like this job. Let's get another job somewhere else. Let's just apply. And because when you're in your 20s, I don't know what you know, you just seem more positive. But I mean, the thought now of looking for a new job after 25 years doing the same job, you know, fills me with horror. Having to go on a training course again and having to go through interviews. Yes. And I think a lot of people stay in their jobs, even if they don't like them when they get older, because they just can't face this. You know, it seems like more of a hassle to change the job than it is to leave.
Well,
that's the position I'm in.
Well, it's fear. That's it. The one thing that grows as you get older is your fear of change, your fear of doing something different. And again, what you do in your 30s and what you do in your 50s or 60s is different. Different. You can't escape that. I think that is almost the lesson that everyone learns.
I would say that's the biggest change I've noticed.
But it's not necessarily bad or depressing or negative. So I think that is really the lesson that I would take away from this today. Is it isn't necessarily a bad thing. And sometimes you do have to push yourself. You have to take those little risks. You have to go outside. You have to book a holiday to a place you've never been. You have to go to a social event.
Well, and
maybe you will meet some great people.
Well, that's the thing about holidays. We end up going to the same place every time, because we're not adventurous enough anymore. Yeah. We go back to, you know, Lake Vyrnwy in Wales, God knows how many times, because it's safe, we know it all. We all know people like that go to the same holiday resort every year, because you get to a point where, I mean, you enjoy it, but it's not necessarily a bad thing. But
it becomes routine.
Yes.
Yeah. But I remember the one time, I remember when we literally, we didn't have our suitcases packed. We had nothing packed, and Steve booked a flight, a holiday for the next day.
Yes.
And we had to go and get our suitcases from out of the attic, and we had to pack our suitcases, and we hadn't planned it. So we did that in an afternoon, just spontaneously, and the next day we were at the airport getting on a plane.
I mean, now, to think the thought of doing that now, we'd need 2 weeks to plan what to get.
I would have sleepless nights.
We just threw things into a suitcase and just went on the, you know, just went off the next day.
Yeah, I think that was our first, was that Madeira?
I think it was Turkey. Yes.
I think it was our first trip to Turkey, and it was spontaneous. And the next day we were flying to Turkey, and it was the most amazing adventure. In fact, I filmed a lesson. I actually filmed a lesson there during that first trip. And I remember that the night before, I know this is not an interesting story, I'm sorry, but the night before, I wrote the script for the lesson the night before. So we'd booked the holiday, and then I knew we were going, and I sat down in front of the computer and I wrote the script for going on holiday, the lesson all about going on holiday, which is on my YouTube channel. So I did all that the night before. I rushed everything. And I can't believe how well it turned out, because I still can't believe that.
Sometimes you just need to be spontaneous. But yes, I mean, it's like me and my... I'm always going... People who watch regularly know I'm always going on about buying a Ford Mustang. Well, the only reason I haven't is because I'm too afraid to take the plunge. you know, oh, I've got to borrow some money. Oh, what happens if I lose my job, and then I've got to sell the car, and then what will people think? And then I'll, you know, all those sort of doubts creep into your mind, which they don't when you're younger. So I think that's the main difference I've noticed, is that you get more doubts and more, you get more sort of all the negative. Maybe that's just me.
Well, no, I think we were. I think we were a little bit more spontaneous when we were young, but it's hard to hold on to that joy de vivre. Is that the one? Is that what we say?
Joie de vivre.
Joie de vivre, the joy of life. And sometimes you have to hold it very tightly in your hand because it's very easy to lose it, to let it slip.
Ernest Tekin says here, thank you for your comment. Literally, even though I'm 25, I can't find the energy to take my bag to hit the road either. I can't consider myself in your ages.
Oh, I see.
Well, yes, see, that's interesting. I think what'll happen is that that fear as we get older will go, and I think it'll be replaced with a, you know, we'll suddenly see that, you know, there's less time ahead, and we'll have a last fling.
Yes, suddenly everything we will just do everything.
I think we'll get into our 70s. And then we'll have like a last fling. We'll just go partying every. I used to have an auntie.
Okay.
I used to have an auntie who was, she was, you know, she was in her 70s at the time when I was very young, you know, in my teens or something like that. Would she be an auntie? I can't remember, but she was a very, you know, and yes, she was an auntie. And she's not alive anymore. But I mean, in her 60s and 70s, she was dancing on the tables at parties and things. And I always remember that. She was so full of life. She just enjoyed herself. And yet, you know, my family was all very, fancy doing that. It was all, it was like a, you know, and she was enjoying herself.
Your family are a bit prudish.
That they are. So, you know, any sign of enjoyment must be suppressed at all costs.
Yes,
because it's all about, you know, how you look to other people.
Anyway, before we start,
I had this one auntie that see, literally get up on tables and dance, and she used to get drunk and everything. And she was, looking back now, she was wonderful. That's what I want to be like when I get older. I want to be older, but just enjoy myself.
I cannot imagine you enjoying anything.
Thanks.
Well, you're not a person who lets yourself go. I am.
I do sometimes. I do let myself go. When I'm here on the live stream, I let myself go.
We were talking about this earlier, not here on the live chat, but earlier this morning. And I can remember the last thing you and I did that was adventurous and dangerous. And that was the night that you wanted to go out to test your new tyres on your car. And we'd had lots of snow, and then there was lots of freezing ice.
So I bought these winter tyres.
Okay, yes.
Well, you've got to explain why I wanted to go out.
Yes.
I bought tyres which were proper winter tyres.
That's it. So we decided to go out, but it was treacherous. People weren't even going out, were they? They weren't driving on the road. No one was going anywhere because the roads were so dangerous. So we went out of the car and we were driving down the road with your car swerving and snaking along the road.
Well, of course, it wasn't. You know,
no,
it was,
but I haven't finished the sentence.
Carry on then.
And I remember how much in control you were of the car. You really got into it, and you should have seen Steve's face. He was really enjoying himself. There is no happier person than Steve driving a car that is about 60% out of control, because we've done this in the past. I'm trying to talk about the things we've done that are exciting, not the negative stuff.
Well, I was going to comment on the story. Yeah, okay. it was just a bit of, you know, going out in the, because I used to do that when I was younger.
It was exciting.
Me and my friend, we had these little sports cars. These, you know, we bought them very cheaply, and I had an MG Midget, and he had a Triumph Spitfire, which was small. And you know, we bought them second hand, got them cheaply, and we used to go zooming off around the country lanes. And that's what I've always, that's always been my excitement, cars and driving.
That's the point I made.
Yes.
I never see Steve any more happy than when he's in a car with this the steering wheel in front of
We're
him.
Talking about cars.
And he's go. No, let me just. We can't talk about. We're not talking about cars. We're talking about life experiences.
We've got to cheer Tomek up today, by the way. He's retracted his statement, I've already read it.
What about the other...
Everybody.
100 people on the
Tomek life. Says that his life's going downhill. Yeah. We don't know if it's true, but... Just us being here should be hopefully enough.
What about William? What does William think?
Maybe we don't know.
Nowadays, I work as a tax analyst, and it's hard because touching... What's that? Touching the organ of the most... sensitive human body, which is the wallet. Oh yes, I suppose that is a part of the body.
Well, that's not going to cheer us up talking about taxes.
No, but thank you, William, for your input on the live chat today. There was also the time when we were in Greece and we decided to drive to the top of the tallest hill on the island. It was Corfu, and we almost destroyed the car. It was a tiny little car, wasn't it, that we hired. And we didn't realise just how bad the road was going up this old volcanic mountain.
Pantocrator.
Yes. And we almost destroyed the car. The car, there was smoke coming from under the bonnet. The brakes were doing something weird. The suspension, I think we almost broke the car completely.
Never buy a hire car, because you know they've been thrashed.
Well, that one certainly has.
Something's been thrashed.
Yes.
It means it's been worked very hard, almost to the point of destruction.
Mm. So that's the story of when we just decided to drive up to the top of the mountain, a rocky mountain, in a tiny car that was not designed to do it. So that was quite adventurous as well. I'm not going to mention going to China because everyone always complains. They said, oh, here we go. Mr. Duncan's talking about China again. OK, so I'm not going to talk about that, but it was exciting and it was quite an adventure. There you go. That's all I'm saying about that. Today we're looking at something interesting, Steve. Gender-specific words.
Didn't we do that the other week?
Nope.
Oh, right, OK.
No, we didn't.
I thought we were going to talk about May Day.
Well, we are.
Oh, right, OK.
Well, we've got plenty of time.
May Day and gender-specific words. Okay.
Well, that's what's coming up later, you see. We call that we call it a teaser. We're teasing, you see. We're saying...
Oh, look at that. Thank you very much for that lovely comment.
What lovely comment?
From Tomek.
Oh, OK. Hello, Tomek again.
Yes.
Yes. And all the other people that we're not talking to on the live chat.
Please don't retract that statement. Leave that one on.
OK. We went yesterday for a lovely walk into town and we saw a magical sight. And there it is. Yesterday we saw some beautiful bluebells. At this time of year, if you look carefully, you can't find them easily. But you do have to look for them. You have to search for them. Bluebells are one of the most beautiful flowers. And you quite often see them at this time of year. However, they are not easy to find because they only grow in certain places, in certain situations where the land or the ground has not been disturbed. So you have to sometimes search quite carefully and closely to find bluebells. So there you can see yesterday we were walking and there were lots of beautiful bluebells. And do you know why they're called bluebells?
Because they're blue and their flowers are shaped like a bell.
Yes. Well, yes, of course, because that's what they do, you see. They often say, we've got to name this flower. Well, it's blue. Shall we say blue? Okay, then. And it looks like a bell. Shall we call it a bluebell? And there it is, you see. Yes, it does look like a bell. You are right. So there they are yesterday. Beautiful bluebells. Oh, nothing says spring in England like a bluebell. And there it was.
Yes, you normally only see them in wooded areas because they like to grow in the shade.
Mm.
Well, they like to... Well, when I say grow in the shade... They need to grow before the leaves from the trees block out the light. Mm. So they have this small window of opportunity, this small period of maybe a few weeks where when the light is coming through. This is a deciduous forest, of course. Mm. You wouldn't see them in a conifer forest. You'd see them in a deciduous forest where there's a lot more light comes in before the leaves of the trees come out. And they've got this little opportunity. So you can see people go on special woodland walks.
Yeah, they travel miles.
Just to see a carpet of bluebells as far as the eye can see in deciduous forests, particularly in the UK, probably in other parts, probably in France and other parts of Europe.
Well, they grow everywhere.
But yes.
But they're hard to find. But can you
believe
it?
They're a bulb. I think they're a kind of bulb.
I forgot that we have them in our front garden. When we came back yesterday from our walk, I was so excited about the bluebells. And then I realized in the corner of our front garden, we have a small area and there are bluebells growing. In that area.
The previous owners must have put them in.
Yes.
And they come up every year for a few weeks. But yes, they are bluebells and they're nice. We could have just stayed at home and filmed them.
Yes. After all that effort. And did you know that you're not supposed to pick them or move them? You can't dig them up.
Why is that?
They're protected.
Oh right.
Yes. Did you know that?
If you
dig the bluebells and take them home and somebody finds out, you can actually be fined for it because they are rare.
A bit like the wild garlic that comes out at this time of the year, that is making use of the fact that there's more light coming down to the ground from the forest before the leaves on the trees come out. So they are competing in a way with the bluebells.
Mm.
And in fact, the wild garlic is seen as a kind of as a competitor trying to outdo the bluebells in certain parts of the countries, and they're trying to get rid of the wild garlic because it's destroying the bluebells. It's
like a battle
invading.
There's a battle taking place between the wild garlic and the bluebells.
Yes, I'm not sure if certain types of wild garlic have come from other parts of the world and are more invasive. But anyway,
today is May Day. Do you know why we have May Day? Well, of course, it's for the workers. As I said earlier, a lot of people are commemorating the rights of the workers and all of the rights and the freedoms that workers now enjoy that had to be fought for. They weren't given away, so many people had to fight. Many people lost their lives to get the workers' rights that most people enjoy today. Also, there is another thing as well, Steve. Have you ever heard, well, I hope you never hear it. You never hear anyone calling Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. Mayday.
Three times.
Yes.
Yes, so Mayday, two separate words, the month of May and day, and Mayday, which is M-A-Y-D-A-Y in one word.
Good.
There we go. You've got it there.
And there it is. Mayday is often used as a distress call as well, maybe on an aeroplane, quite often on an aeroplane, or maybe on a ship that is in trouble. Mayday as a distress call. Did you know it derives from the French phrase, Venez m'aider, which means come and help me. So that's why we say Mayday. It actually derives from French, the French phrase that literally means come and help me. And that's why we say Mayday to this very day.
And it was a radio officer in Croydon, apparently, who first decided that this would be a good idea for people in distress. To call this out. And it was around, I think it was 1940s when it was adopted as a phrase, the international phrase to say that when you're in distress.
Yeah, it's a call sign.
I often feel like saying it, you know, halfway through the live stream every Sunday.
Maybe we could have a thing. Maybe we could have a thing that we put on the screen that says Mayday, Mayday. We've We've run out of things to talk about. Is there anyone out there who has a suggestion?
Well, Vitas and also Edith as well has just pointed out that, in fact, it's the 1st of May here, which is May Day, and we've got a bank holiday tomorrow, so we get a day off.
Public holiday.
But it's also Mother's Day in certain parts of the world, where Vitas is that Lithuania?
Lithuania.
And Edith in Hungary, they're celebrating Mother's Day today.
Happy Mother's Day to all those who are celebrating Mother's Day today.
Yes. And yes, as you correctly said, May Day is often used to celebrate workers' rights.
Hmm.
But it's been around for hundreds of years.
Yes. Well, it used to be also a big celebration where the fair maidens,
yes,
or virgins would dance around a large pole.
Yes.
We all know what this is about. You don't need me to even explain what this is for. But it's all about fertility and making sure that everything is good and fertile for the forthcoming summer. So that's one of the traditions we do here, and I think in certain parts of the world as well.
We dance around the maypole.
The maypole, but normally it's fair maidens.
Yes, and then you get the queen, the May Queen. So somebody, one of the girls, probably the prettiest, I would imagine, hang on a minute, we've got somebody whose birthday is in May, Christina.
Oh.
If Christina is still on.
When is your birthday? When is it?
When is it? But Christina says she was born in May. So are you a May Queen?
Yes.
Is what we want to know. Are you the queen of the maidens?
Maybe
well,
you.
We're not going to inquire whether you are a maiden.
Yes.
That's a bit too personal. But yes, it as you say, that dancing around the maypole, that pole is seen as a bit of a fertility symbol.
Yes.
But it could be just, you know, pointing to the centre of the earth or something.
No, it isn't.
Well, some people think, you know.
It is 100% phallic.
Disgusting. Anyway, right.
That's not disgusting.
I know. And also, apparently, as I say, it's had many different connotations over the year. It's supposed to symbolise perhaps the transition from spring into summer.
Hmm.
And also the Roman Catholics used to and may still celebrate it as, you know, a Virgin Mary celebration as well, apparently. Catholics used to celebrate May Day as a sort of symbol of Mary or something. I don't know exactly the details.
No, it sounds like it.
But I did read about that, yes, and it's been used for centuries for various ways. Hmm. But as you pointed out recently, for workers' rights. And
yes,
there's often protests on May Day.
Yes. The workers will come out and they will show their... A great word that I love, solidarity. I don't know why. I love that word. It sort of rolls out of your mouth so eloquently. Solidarity. The solidarity is the union of people who have come together and they join together for a common purpose, or maybe because they share some sort of bond. So we often talk about solidarity, especially when we're talking about workers' rights unions, you see. So that's why we have the word union. The union is the group of people who represent or belong to a certain group of workers. So that's how we get the word union. They are together.
Yes.
As one. Just like we are today.
I don't have any rights at all. I've got no workers' rights on this live stream. I don't get a pension. I don't get paid.
No, nor do I.
I don't get any time off.
I don't get... I also don't get either of those things anymore.
It's about time I formed a union to get some workers' rights, because, you know, it's like slavery being on Mr. Duncan's live stream.
I might have to go back to selling my body again, like I did in my 20s when I used to stand on that street corner in Birmingham.
Yes, exactly.
What?
Ludmilla, hello from Siberia. I don't think we've ever had anybody from Siberia before.
I don't think so either. Hello, Siberia.
You're the first person we've ever had from Siberia.
I suppose the most obvious question, Steve, is...
What?
What do you think? What do you think the most obvious question?
Is it cold?
Yes.
Right.
Is it cold?
Yes, sorry, Ludmilla, but whenever we think of Siberia in the UK, we think of frozen wasteland. But we know that's not true because we've also seen lovely... in fact, there was a programme not so long ago, a number of years ago, about Siberia. And we saw the different side to it.
Mm.
You know, obviously it does get cold and snowy. But then, you know, the spring and summer like there is here.
Aren't they beautiful? Aren't there gulags in Siberia, in the middle of nowhere? That's another thing I watched on TV. Besides Mr. Steve's documentary, I also saw something about these prisons that are in the middle of nowhere. I'm sure they're in Siberia.
Well, that's a good place to have a prison.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if you've got your... Because obviously Russia being a gigantic country and Siberia being huge. I mean, prisons here in the UK, if someone was to escape, you know, they are always within probably 5 miles of a town.
Mm.
Whereas if you've got, your worst murderers and most horrible people, putting them into a prison in Siberia, if they escape, it doesn't matter because they'll die before they get anywhere near anyone. So I think that's a great idea.
That is probably the thinking behind that.
Yes.
Although maybe that's a subject we shouldn't get too deep into.
Yes,
for
exactly.
Various reasons.
Yes, Tomek points out the solidarity movement in Poland, which was the workers' rights.
Mm. Well, I always remember Lech Wałęsa.
Yeah, exactly. Yes,
Lech Wałęsa, who was the leader. I think he was he the president for a while, wasn't he?
I think he was the union leader, and he got the rights, and then he became president, didn't he?
I always remember Lech Wałęsa as being one of those faces that was always on television.
Yes,
as a child
in the '80s,
you always saw his face everywhere on the TV. There was always a news story, and quite often it was involving unions, workers fighting. Literally, in some cases, fighting for their rights.
And Nitram says that in the Czech Republic, it's Workers' Day. It is definitely Workers' Day tomorrow. So presumably, do you have a bank holiday? Do you have a public holiday, I should say?
That's it.
We call them bank holidays here, but we mean public holidays.
We've got lots of holidays coming up, by the way, in June, because... Am I the only person? Can I just say something now? I know someone is going to be offended and you're going to throw your computer out of your window. I am so sick and tired of hearing about the Platinum Jubilee.
I'm not.
I am absolutely sick of it already. It hasn't happened. And they're giving us a long holiday, aren't they?
2 days off.
And I don't want it. Can I do something else? I might do something else instead.
Oh, so it'll be fun to watch.
The Queen is celebrating 70 years on the throne.
Which is quite an achievement.
Which is quite an achievement, but I'm sick of hearing about it.
Yes, I mean, they do talk about it a lot.
Well, you were complaining to your mum the other night about it. You said, I don't know what all the fuss is about.
Well, what I meant was... We're supposed to be having 4 days of celebration.
Yeah.
The Thursday, the Friday, which are now public holidays, and then the Saturday and the Sunday.
Mm.
And I mean, my point was, I think it's just a bit too much.
Too much.
4 days. Okay.
Yeah.
It's, you know, we love the Queen. We love our Queen. But I think 4 days is a bit much.
I love my Queen.
But, yeah. Are you a May Queen?
So
we haven't heard from Christina yet, if she's still here.
So I'm not looking forward to that.
Oh, yes.
Can I just say what put me off? Because they were talking about all of the celebrations. There is one word that always puts me off something. If you want to stop me from going somewhere, maybe to an event or a celebration, use the word acrobat. I don't know why. Whenever anyone says, come to this festival, there will be acrobats. I immediately switch off.
So you're not a fan of the circus?
Well, it's just, I know it's going to be terrible. Whatever it is, I know it's going to be awful. So apparently they're going to have double-decker buses with acrobats on them. And I know it's going to be terrible. It's going to look awful. And I think also it's going to rain as well. So I can guarantee it's
going... It's bound to rain.
It will rain. So the whole thing is just going to be this grey, wet, damp, soggy mess. Acrobats. Nothing puts me off something quicker than saying there will be acrobats.
Yes, but I mean, look at some of the performers they've got there enough to put you off as well. I mean, Cliff Richard has been around for many, many decades.
Does
and
anyone,
he's very successful.
Yeah, does anyone know who he is? Cliff Richard.
I would imagine a lot of people do know.
He's so old. His music predates records and CDs. They used to just write it down on pieces of paper. And then later they got those old wax cylinders where the music sounded...
He's joking. The thing is that Cliff Richard, which is a sort of famous pop star from the 60s and 70s in the UK, has probably more number one hits than anybody else. The thing is, he performed at the last Jubilee 10 years ago.
No one mentions that now.
And, when you get into your 70s, you're not going to be vocally at your best anymore.
No.
And he wasn't very good. It all looked a bit tired and a bit... it looked a bit embarrassing.
The worst part of it, though, was Paul McCartney trying to sing.
Well, yeah.
He did this terrible rendition of Hey Jude, and at the end, he was just shouting and screaming his head off.
Maybe that's what I'm thinking of.
And, of course, one of the main acts from the previous celebration was now a guy who went to prison for being a child molester, which doesn't help, really. So we have some very strange mixed memories of previous celebrations of the Queen. And of course, let's not forget, the royal family in this country is not without its problems for various reasons. So I will be glad when it's gone, to be honest. I just want to move on.
See, Victoria loves anything to do with a circus. So just because you and I don't like acrobats, it doesn't mean that other people won't.
I like acrobats in the circus. You see, you're misunderstanding me, Steve. See, that's it. I don't mind acrobats. If I'm going to a circus with the big tent and I go inside and there's people swinging and catching each other and people throwing knives. It sounds like a night out in Birmingham, I know. But I love it. I love the circus. But if you take that and try to introduce it into anything else, it's normally awful.
But anyway, let's see. Let's not judge it. Let's see it and then we can pull it apart afterwards.
I want to bet some money that it's going to be terrible, it's going to rain, and maybe by then Prince Andrew will be in jail.
You see, you're being very negative, Mr. Duncan. I think you're being very, very negative. Victoria says, singers tend to lose their voice when they get older. Yeah. Well, they've got Shirley. I mean, I'm a huge fan of Shirley Bassey.
She will be there.
She's going to be there. But really, you know, her voice isn't what it was. And I just think it's sad when they carry on performing. But I guess, you know, if that's all you've ever done and you love doing it, then you're not going to want to stop doing it, are you? It's like you with the live streams. You love doing the live stream. So even when they become terrible when you're in your 80s, you'll probably still carry on doing them.
Thanks.
Let's hope people are still watching.
I think
imagine that, Mr. Duncan, you doing live streams in your 80s.
Can you imagine me standing here like a very elderly man and I'm going, hello, everyone. Welcome to English with Mr. Duncan, or as many people now call me, Mr. Wrinkly.
You'll have to have a chair with those wings at the side.
Really?
The ones that they have at nursing homes, so that when old people fall asleep, their heads just go against these big wings.
I know what I'm going to be doing. I'm going to be sitting on one of those mobile commodes. so I can actually do the live stream whilst I'm having my own live stream down there. You see,
no one will know.
Because of my age, you will just hear the occasional noise, like running water or air escaping.
Well, yeah, so yes. People are, yeah, it's it'll be interesting to see. Hello, Pedro.
Ooh.
Yes, I'm good today. Thank you very much.
Pedro Belmont.
Much better, getting better. You know, talking of voices, I still, you know, 3 weeks later can't sing properly.
Yes.
But hoping that that will soon pass.
Mm. I like the circus. Don't get me wrong. It's just when you have acrobats in places where they probably shouldn't be.
Some people say this is a circus act.
Well, we've certainly
like
got
a circus act.
We've certainly got the clowns.
We're a couple of clowns, aren't we? Some people will probably definitely agree with that.
Speak for yourself.
Yes, yeah, so there we go. Yes. Well, you brought up the subject of the Queen, which relates to the May Queen, of course.
Okay.
So, one Queen to another, what are we talking about next?
Well, we're talking about our main subject. We have half an hour left. If you've just joined us, hello, good afternoon. Welcome to our live stream on the internet, where everyone is free to express themselves. Whatever it is you want to say, as long as YouTube doesn't mind. And maybe Elon Musk will give his thumbs up, you see, because he likes everything. Unless, of course, you're criticizing his cars, in which case he won't let you go to his press conferences, apparently. Apparently he likes freedom of speech unless you're criticizing his electric cars.
That'll be interesting to see if people... Now that he's, well, I don't think it's the deal's gone through yet, but
everyone keeps saying he's bought Twitter, but he hasn't yet. Apparently he hasn't got enough money. Can you believe it? He's the richest man in the world and he can't afford to buy Twitter. So he's had to go to a bank, Morgan Stanley. So it's actually a big faceless bank that's technically going to own Twitter. So it will be interesting to see what happens.
It'll be interesting to see, as you say, whether he will let people criticise his cars.
Hmm.
Not that there's a lot to criticise them for. I hear they're quite good.
Anyway.
But there you go.
That's it. We're straying off the road a bit there, literally. Here we go. We have what some people think is a controversial subject, but I don't think it is. Anyone who says that...
Well, we never shy away from controversy, Mr. Duncan.
No, although no
we
one
hit it head on.
I have noticed that no one cares. No one. We could say anything on here. We really could, and no one cares. They don't. They go. Oh, it's just those two idiots again. Oh, no, I'm taking no notice of them. Today we are looking at gender phrases. Oh, Mr. Duncan, you are being very up to date. Very, very up to date. And what's the other word you can use if something is up to date? Very contemporary.
Contemporary.
Yes, gender phrases. So this is not what it appears to be. Before anyone complains, this is not about the pronouns. This is about the way in which certain gender words are used in phrases and other things. So we're not going to go into that minefield.
Political correctness.
There is, well, it's not even, the problem is it's not even that anymore. It's become its own battleground. So there is no way I'm going there. Mr. Steve is not going there and I'm not going there.
We're not, no, we're just talking about gender-specific phrases.
That's it.
So Tomek's off for a walk, by the way.
Okay, good. See you, Tomek.
Have a nice stroll. Well, why don't you wait 20 minutes and then go?
Here we go, Steve. Can I just carry on with this now?
Of course.
It is common to use gender-related words in certain phrases as a means of expression. So you can see now what we are doing. We're not looking at gender as such. We are looking at the way in which words are used in phrases and expressions. So it's a very different thing. But it does relate, I suppose, in certain ways to modern life as well. Gender-related words might refer to to a certain type of job or an object. So, yes, it can happen. It can happen. For example, Steve, we can have postman, postman, or postwoman. The postwoman pushed her large package through my door, or the postman, of course. I've had many large packages pushed through my letterbox by my postman. Workman, the workman, was making a lot of noise outside, and also milkman as well. Yes. So in that respect, you can see something happening there, can't you, Steve?
Yes, a lot of phrases attached to the male aspect there.
Mm.
Because, of course, yeah, you didn't get post women.
No.
Probably when that phrase was invented, you didn't get...
Well, I put post women there.
I know, I'm just saying yes.
So you don't often say work women.
You don't.
I've never heard that phrase. So it's interesting how these words were established during a time when many of the jobs and many of the different types of work were done by men only. And it's interesting. So it is, you might say that these words are like fossils that you dig up. And so because these words still exist, they do echo back into the past. So we often talk about somebody working in the road. You will automatically say workman.
Yes.
Without thinking.
A workman, yes. It's not just a person that works. A workman is somebody who's doing like a manual job, isn't
yes.
it? A heavy manual job, like digging up a road, that sort of thing. A workman at the side of the road. Yes, and because you don't see many women doing labour-intensive jobs like digging up roads, then there wouldn't be an equivalent word for a woman doing that, because I don't think I've, might correct me if I'm wrong, I've never seen a woman with a jackhammer at the side of the road digging up a road.
Jackhammer, I used to go to school with him.
Yes.
So a workman, we often say workman without thinking. We're not being rude
no.
when we do it. It's just that word came around. It was introduced at the time when most heavy labour was carried out by men. And I suppose another one is milkman as well.
Yes.
I will still say milkman. I won't say anything else. I say, oh, has the milkman come? I notice our neighbour has started using the milkman. They have a milkman that goes round. So even if it's a woman delivering the milk, I will still automatically say milkman.
Yes, as has just been pointed out on the live stream, thank you, that there are a lot of gender-specific roles or jobs anyway. So, I mean, teacher, for example, you don't say teachman, do you? It's teacher. Because you've always had a male or a female teacher.
Yes.
It's not like teachers have always been one sex, for example. But a workman, somebody who does heavy manual work, is 99.9 times out of 100 going to be a man.
Having said that, can I just make a point there? Because you mentioned education. That is a whole nother subject.
I just drunk out of that. It was empty.
It's a whole different aspect when we talk about education, because there are many phrases. So we might have master. Master is often used in universities. And then, of course, we have headmaster, headmistress as well.
Yes.
So there are divides with gender when we look at education. But again, I suppose it's worth mentioning that traditionally and in the olden days, education was seen as something that only men did. So it's not about being sexist or referring to the way we live now, but those ways of expressing the words and when they were created comes from a time when things were different.
You see, I'm in my occupation is sales. And when I grew up, and that's the thing. So certain occupations that seem to be gender specific
mm.
have been over the years. There's been debates about it, and they've had to change the name.
Yeah,
but not for ones like workmen, because people doing manual work are always men.
Yes, and also that's a generic term as well.
Yes,
and of course, like with you, you're salesman.
Always was salesman because you didn't get many women in sales, but now of course you do. In fact, there's more women in the company I work for doing sales than there are men.
Mm.
So. You don't use the phrase salesman anymore. You just use, well, we're not even called sales. We're not called sales anymore. We're called account managers.
Yes, account managers or advisors. That's another good one.
They've dropped sales out of the whole thing. But you would say saleswoman, definitely.
Hmm.
You could say I'm a saleswoman.
Yes, maybe in a...
Well, I wouldn't say that. But
maybe in a retail environment as well. So a saleswoman...
Or a sales assistant.
A saleswoman would be the female serving you in a shop, for example.
Salesperson.
Yes.
But you wouldn't say, as some words, you wouldn't say milk person.
Yeah. Here's another one.
It isn't a phrase that's used.
No. No one says milk person.
Or milk deliverer.
Yes.
I don't know whether there are many women that deliver milk. Of course, we don't get milk delivered anymore. It used to be that's how everybody got their milk. When I grew up, but now everybody gets their milk from a supermarket. So there aren't many people delivering milk door to door anyway in the UK. Virtually, you know, it's virtually an occupation that's vanished.
It has come back.
It's come back a bit, but generally people...
Apparently,
you know,
in London, they've gone crazy over having milk deliveries. They've gone mad over it. Here are two, Steve. I don't want any comments from you. Manhole.
Yes.
When was the last time you looked inside a manhole? Have you ever been in a manhole?
It's been years, Mr. Duncan.
I remember as a child being fascinated by manholes, which explains a lot.
And you became even more fascinated when you got into your late teens and early 20s.
I don't know what I don't know what you mean by that. So a manhole is often used to describe a certain thing, a certain type of object. I used to lift up the manhole covers. I was always fascinated because I would walk along the street and
there
would
be... Had you got the strength to lift them up?
Well, you can get them up if you use you can use something heavy to lift it up. I was always fascinated, and then now and again they would come to clean the drains, so that these big machines would come and they would take the manhole cover.
Yes, we probably need to explain the word.
I'm going to. I've got lots of other things I'm still doing. It's all right, Steve, we'll get round to that. So manhole and manhandle is also used as well. We are looking at these words again in a few moments, so don't panic. In the past, the gender of the person carrying out a task would be used, so it would be specific. Over the years, the use of gender in job roles has become neutral. So I think it would be fair to say over the years, it's become neutral. Oh, I think we have a super chat, don't we?
I think we do.
Thank you very much for your super chat. I can't read your name because it is not written in English. So I might try to translate that if I can. I will try my best to do that in a couple of moments. But thank you very much for your donation on the live chat. And I love your little icon as well, the little super chat. It looks like Mr. Steve. I think that might be you, Steve, actually.
I can't see it. Hello, Mahmood. Coming back for the first time for a long time. So welcome back, Mahmood.
Where was I? Over the years, the use of gender in job roles has become neutral. So we often find that there are words and phrases that are not specified or directed at one particular gender. For example, as we mentioned earlier, postman and postwoman. Well, nowadays, we like to go with something that's neutral. So a neutral phrase means it's not specifying or naming a particular gender. Postal worker is what we do now. So that's what we say now. We don't say postman or postwoman. Quite often we will say postal worker. Postal worker.
Oh.
Hello, Yane. Yane, and I believe you are in Korea. Hello to you, Yane. I am Korean. A big hello to Korea. We do have a lot of people watching in your part of the world, actually. Thank you very much for your super chat. We do appreciate it. Thank you very much. Here's another one, Steve. Postal worker. What about policeman and
yes,
policeman and policewoman? When was the last time you were grabbed hold of
by a man in uniform?
By a man in uniform.
The last time was when I was speeding. Yes, we don't. We transitioned, didn't we? We used to just say policeman. Then women entered the police force and we said policewoman.
Mm-hmm.
But as you say, we don't use either of those phrases. I think you probably can still use those phrases, but police officer is what is the phrase which is used now to describe somebody in the police.
So we've taken away the gender and we just say police officer. Police officer, or maybe their rank, police sergeant. A police sergeant, police officer, instead of being specific with the gender. Now, this is a difficult one. This is one that causes a little bit of trouble sometimes. Air steward or air hostess. So when you are on an aeroplane, that's the person who shows you how to get out of the plane if it crashes into the sea, but you never take any notice of it. To this day, I still don't know what I have to do. If I'm on a plane and something goes wrong, I will have no idea what to do. I will scream, panic, but because I never take any notice of that person at the front when they're directing you. They're saying that the exits are over here and up there, and then you have to take the thing and then you put it over your neck and then you have to inflate it with your mouth. That's the only part I remember.
Of course, that's an interesting example you put up there, Mr. Duncan, because then there didn't used to be male people working as cabin crew. You know, when planes first took to the air, that was traditionally a female role, wasn't it?
I thought you were going to say they used dogs instead.
The hostess, the air hostess, was always a woman's role, and then of course men started coming into that role and they were given the name an air steward, and now everyone is just called cabin crew.
Yeah,
so there's often this transition, isn't there, from one phrase to another. The phrase you use now is cabin crew. I think you probably can still say an air steward or a steward or an air hostess.
Yeah, I do like stewardess. That the reason why I like that is because, as you said, it was women who originally did the job, and it was men who moved in to that profession.
Yes.
Quite often, men who are very, what's the word I'm looking for?
Like us.
Light on their feet. Air steward, air hostess. Quite often we refer to them as cabin crew. Also, we can say flight attendant as well.
Yes.
In fact, you might find flight attendant is used more than cabin crew. But yeah, so there are other ways of expressing that as well.
Nitram says that Mel Gibson, when addressing a policewoman, uses the phrase sugar tits. I didn't know that. Maybe you can give us some context there, Nitram. I don't know. Maybe there was a court case or something. I don't know. I'm just thinking there might be some context there.
Okay. The context might be...
Flight attendant. Yeah, that's another phrase. Did we have flight attendant, did we?
A flight attendant.
Yes.
Or a flight... cabin crew.
They've really had a lot of different phrases, haven't they, to describe their role.
Here's an interesting one. So this is one that has become just the male definition. So you might say that they've been combined and they've become one. We used to say actor and actress.
Because women weren't, I don't think, allowed to act on the stage at certain points in history. It was always men, wasn't it? And then women, of course, more recently, actress. But as you say,
I'm not sure if any of what you just said is true.
No, I think it was true.
You mean you are telling me that there was a time when only plays and anything performed was only men?
Yes, because if there was a female role, quite often the man would have to dress up as a woman. I think yes, because we're going back in history. I don't know when that was, but going back in history, quite often women were barred from certain roles, and I think one of them was acting at one point. But as you say now, that phrase has been, we don't say actor, actress. Actor would indicate it was a male person. Actress would indicate a woman. But now we just use the word actor for both sexes. Mm. So, yes.
So exactly. It's become, so Meryl Streep is an actor.
Yeah, that's a funny one to get your head round, really, because actor you think of as a male person on a stage.
See, the reason why they've done that is that I think they want to say that the actress is as good as a male, as a man, so that the female actor is as good as the male actor. So they've both adopted the word actor.
Yes.
Fireman.
Yes, Victoria says that in time of Shakespeare, actors play the women roles.
Interesting.
Firemen and firewomen.
Yes. So you might have a fireman or a firewoman, but we often don't do that. And I have seen women with attending fires.
Yes.
Not starting them, putting them out. Although women do tend to start a lot of fires.
Sexist comment, Mr. Duncan.
Arguments, I mean. Firefighter. A firefighter is the general term for a person who sprays the water on a fire.
Goes into the burning building and says, but yeah, it's quite common now for women to enter the fire service, as it is the police force as well.
So we just tend to say these days firefighter. Author. Now, this is an interesting one again. Author. An author, a person who writes books. So in that sense, the author is the male and authoress is the female. However, these days we often just say author.
Yeah.
Author. So very similar to actor. So the one word has been now adopted by both genders. So an author. So you might say that William Shakespeare was an author or a playwright. And you might say, who else? Who can I name? I want to name a female author who I'm going to mention, and no one is going to react in a negative way. J.K. Rowling is an author. Very,
yes.
Very popular. She wrote all about Harry Potter and other things. Some phrases have not changed. Now, this is interesting. So we might think of many phrases that have changed, but there are also a lot of phrases that have not changed. Waiter and waitress are generally still acceptable in everyday use. So you will still say waiter if it's a man serving you at the table. And you will still say waitress if it's a lady.
Come here, waiter.
Serving at the table.
Yes.
So waiter and waitress you will still hear used, because there isn't really another term. You wouldn't really say waiter if it was a girl, because it doesn't sound right. So I still think this almost has a feeling of respect, I think. So I think the reason why these two words are still used often is because they're quite respectful. So you are acknowledging the fact that that is a lady serving you at the table. Waiter and waitress.
We have people pointing out professions which don't have a sex attached to them, like musician, for example.
Well,
architect.
They are actually generic terms as well. So they, a bit like what you said earlier with teacher. So teacher is the generic term for all of the aspects of education. Architect is another good one. All aspects of design, quite often involving buildings.
Yes, even though probably there wouldn't have been, you know, 50, 100 years ago, there wouldn't have been many women architects, if any at all. That was never a gender-specific name attached to it. It was just architect, musician. Parissa has pointed out cameraman.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Another example of one that was gender-specific occupation. What you would say probably camera operator now, wouldn't you?
Yes. That is actually, yeah, well pointed out there.
Parissa, thank you very much for
very
that.
Very good, yes. Cameraman, camerawoman, camera operator, the person who is operating the camera. I like that one.
Yes, Christina. Geologist, just could be male or female. There's no gender specific name for a geologist. Not that I know of.
Certain phrases use gender specific terms, such as manhole. So we mentioned this earlier. Manhole is an access opening, quite often found on the pavement or the sidewalk or in the middle of a road, and normally an opening that you can climb into or crawl into, and quite often there is something that seals that opening closed,
like a drain cover.
Yes, so manhole is a general term for an access opening
that presumably a man would have gone down, or probably still does in most cases, to do maintenance or something like that under the streets, in the road. It was, yes, it's just to indicate it's a hole that a man goes down.
Well, can I just say, did you know that the word man derives from the word hand? So actually that might not be gender specific. It might actually refer to the fact that you open it with your hand. So a manhole would be, that's why we have the word manual. Manual means to do something with your hands. So it's actually, I think you'll find that goes in a very different direction, although it appears to be. It appears to be.
Yeah, so maybe a workman might be, maybe we could be completely, anyway.
Okay, man. This is one that gets a lot of people foaming at the mouth. Man, and also mankind.
Oh, yes.
I'm going to explain in great detail in a few moments why that is the case. And it's a big word dump. I've got lots of words and explanations to tell you exactly why that is the case. So we often refer to human life, the existence of human life or the presence of human life, as man or mankind, human life, which these days is something that a lot of people are trying to change or move away from, although you would have to change a lot of exercise books and dictionaries and encyclopedias to change that one, to be honest. Even these days, you will often hear David Attenborough use the term man or mankind.
I think I've heard the word humankind.
Yes.
Mentioned.
And of course, man can be used as a verb as well. Did you know that? If you man something, it means you are controlling or steering something. You are sitting at the controls, you man something.
So nothing to do with gender at all.
Nothing to do with it. It's once again connected to your hands, as the word man.
Man your station.
Yes.
Go to wherever it is you need to go to operate some machinery or a gun or something like that in battle. Yes. Go to your station.
We have other terms. Using man, you may have noticed that most of the words are actually using man, and there is no reason why I'm not choosing only male words. That's just the way it is, that there are very few female words that use women or the female form in the words or terms. So we have man baby. I like this one. A man baby is a childish male, quite often a man who is immature, or maybe he always gets upset, or he always wants to have attention, quite often from his wife, or he gets very upset if he can't have his own way. They will say, oh, he's such a man baby. And then we have man cave.
Because, of course, that's a derogatory term.
Yes, it's negative.
You know, a man never wants to be thought of as acting in a baby way. Mm. Yes. Man cave.
Man cave is a place where the man will often go to do his things, to read his books or to write his letters or to look at his dirty movies instead of in the House of Commons.
It's something that's got a lot to do with marriage, hasn't it? Male and female, you know, a man and a woman getting married, they're in a relationship, but the man wants to have his time to himself somewhere where he can have time to himself away from his wife.
Yes,
that's what that is, and it's not literally a cave. It's often a shed in the garden.
No, it's not an actual cave.
A workshop in the garage, somewhere where a man can go, and quite often it's somewhere, having spoken to lots of friends at work who are married, who have what they describe as a man cave, their wife will often send them there.
Yes.
To get them out of the house. Mm. Because they're being annoying them in some way. Go off to your man cave is something that is a phrase that a wife sometimes uses to her husband.
Of course.
Or he might retreat there to read the newspaper, as you say, to maybe make some models. He might have a hobby. And just wants that time away from his partner.
Yes.
Just to, you know, calm down.
They have their own space.
Yes.
Originally, you see, the man would have a shed, a small wooden building, normally in the garden, and he would go and sit in his shed. So that's where it all started. But nowadays, men have their own sophisticated entertainment rooms with home cinema and maybe a little bar serving drinks.
A man cave is usually some kind of shed in the garden.
Hmm.
That a man can escape to from his wife, or somewhere that his wife sends him to get him out of the house.
Hmm.
from under her feet.
Yes. Here we go. We've got to move on, Steve.
Yep.
Other words include manhandle. Manhandle.
Ooh, yes.
it's not a noun, by the way. If you are thinking of a manhandle, you know what I'm saying out there. You are just as disgusting as I am. Manhandle, if you treat roughly, to treat something roughly, you manhandle that thing. Manpower.
Yes. So if I, yes. All right. Yes. That's it. If you, yeah, treat somebody roughly physically, you're not injuring them. You're just treating them roughly.
Yes.
You know, if you're trying to get somebody out of a room, if you went to a party and someone was causing trouble, you might manhandle them out of the room, literally, physically push them out of the room. But not injuring them. You wouldn't get into a fight.
Manpower. Manpower is often referring to the workforce, the team of people who are doing a specific job, a certain job. Manpower. So we talk about maybe how many people you need to carry out a certain job. You are talking about the manpower. And again,
yes.
Again, this is not necessarily relating to gender. It is once again about doing the work, the manual power, the force needed to complete a job.
Yes, if you wanted to build a new house, or you were building a, you know, a skyscraper, what sort of manpower would you need?
Mm.
You know, it probably comes down to numbers.
Mm.
You know, you might need 30 people to get that building done. They could be male or female, but as you say, the term is to do with the amount of manual work that you might need, or manpower, but it probably has its origins as well in gender as well, I would think.
And now we have man hours. So the man hours relates to your working time. man hours? How long will it take you to carry out that task? How many man hours do you need? So I always find this a strange one. I always find this one that sort of it doesn't seem right. And yet that's exactly what we say. We say man hours.
Yes. Why do you need that term at all? Because it's still hours, whether it's called at man hours or not. How many man hours will it take to complete that task of repairing that hole in the road?
How many man hours? How long will it take to...
Well, it might be that it takes 10 hours. It might take one person 10 hours, but if you have two people, it will only be 5 man hours because you've got two people doing it.
Yes.
We've got one from Valentin here. I'll point that out in a minute when you've finished.
Here is a
you
big...
You might have it anyway.
Okay, we've got a lot of explaining coming up now, Steve, because I'm going to tell you why we use man as a generic term.
Can I mention this first one from Valentin then? Manslaughter.
Well, manslaughter, yes.
Good one, thank you.
That definitely does refer to a person who kills another person, quite often by accident or unintentionally.
Yes. So if you deliberately killed someone, it's murder. If you killed them by accident, say you had an accident in your car, you ran over a cyclist or you had an accident and somebody died, that's manslaughter. You didn't intend to kill them.
Unless, of course, you were waiting on the corner of the street for the person to go by and you killed them. That is premeditated, which, of course, is more serious. So that's the one that you do. You tend to go to prison for life for manslaughter, accidentally, unintentional, not intended. Here we go then. Why do we use man when we are talking about human beings, human life? Well, I'm going to tell you, and there's a lot to get through here, so I hope you'll bear with me.
To keep it brief, Mr. Duncan, my back's aching.
Traditionally, the word man has been used to refer to not only an adult male, but also to human beings in general, regardless of sex. So by that, we mean the gender. So we would say man as a generic term for all human life. There is a historical explanation for this. In Old English, the principal sense of man as a human being in the words were, which is for a woman, sorry, a man, and with for a woman, which you can see now why we have the term wife. They were used to refer specifically to a male person and a female person, respectively. So in Old English, the principal sense of man was a human being, and the words were and with were used to refer specifically. So they were seen as separate. So man was a separate word completely. As we know, everything changed. Subsequently, man replaced were as the normal term for a male person. But at the same time, the older sense, a human being, remained in use. So there was a change where the term man became used as the term for male. In the second half of the 20th century, the generic use of man to refer to human beings in general, as in reptiles, were here long before man appeared on the earth. So in that sense, we're talking about human beings. It became problematic in the future. A lot of people disagreed with that term. So the use is now often regarded as sexist or old-fashioned. However, if you read old literature or old encyclopedias, you will often see the term man used quite often. In some contexts, terms such as the human race or humankind may be used instead of man or mankind, like you said. Certain fixed phrases and sayings, such as time and tide wait for no man, can be easily rephrased. You can change that. For example, time and tide wait for no one. So instead of it being specific to a certain gender, you can just say no one. Alternatives for other related terms exist as well. The noun manpower, for example, we mentioned that, can usually be replaced with staff or crew. And in most cases, the verbal form to man can be expressed as to staff or to operate.
Yeah.
So I mentioned the word man earlier to be in your position of work, but quite often nowadays we might use the word staff or operate instead. These days it is common for neutral terms to be used when referring to a specific job role or when defining meaning through a sentence, which is why many of the words have changed except for the use of man as a generic term for human being, because that's what it originally was. The attributes of gender are usually expressed as masculine and feminine, and that is the general term that we still use nowadays. A feminine thing relates to females, a masculine thing relates to males.
That's me, masculine.
So Steve, you might say that Mr. Steve is the absolute definition of masculinity. I'm not sure what I am. But there you go.
Gender neutral.
I think that is for another day, to be honest. We are going in a moment. I hope you've enjoyed today's...
Can I point out one little thing here from Palmyra,
mm-hmm.
about a nurse?
Okay.
So a nurse, when you think of nurse,
mm-hmm.
you tend to think of a female nurse, don't you? But
yes.
Obviously...
Yes.
Now, that was a job that was traditionally, you know, women did all that, did mostly that. But lots of men are now nurses and do that same role. Is there a specific term, says Palmyra, for a man that is a nurse? And I don't think there is, really.
No,
I think you tend to say male nurse or female nurse,
yes,
don't you?
Or just nurse.
I think you can use the word orderly. I think an orderly... is a male, a sort of a male nurse, as word. I've heard the word orderly used before. Don't think that's used so much now, but you would tend to say just nurse. And it's interesting because when you go, it's interesting thing actually, because quite often it's nice to know if the person you're going to, like doctor, doctor or nurse, you won't know. I mean, when I grew up, there were no male nurses, just female nurses. So now, if you go to your doctor and you're going to see the nurse, in my mind, I expect that person to be female, and it's a bit of a shock when you go to see the nurse and it's a male, because you don't know whether it's male or female.
Does it matter?
Like doctor, I know it doesn't matter. But because you always grew up thinking that a nurse was always a female, then when you go and it's not, it's like physiotherapists. My mother went to have some physiotherapy the other week, and she obviously associates physiotherapy with a female role, and she turned up and it was a man. And, anyway. But there are often... There are some things that you would want to go to a male nurse about, and, you know, certain conditions that you might not want.
Things to do with your willy.
Well, same with women. Women wouldn't necessarily want a male nurse to examine certain parts of them. And people often ask for a male doctor or a female doctor.
Yes.
But, you know, but anyway, that's
a different
subject.
You'll be amazed how many gynecologists are male.
Well, that's it. Well, that's it. I mean, you wouldn't.
If I think of a gynecologist, I would immediately think of a man.
Yes, because that was you didn't get many female doctors. You know, back in the sort of 50s and 60s, it would be a profession that was male dominated, like an MP was a male dominated and still is a male dominated role.
Well, nursing became something associated with women, of course, because of the wars. because hospitals had to be created, built. Suddenly everyone had to take care of the injured soldiers. And of course, the soldiers were mainly men. And so the only people left to take care of the injured, of course, were women.
And during the war, of course, females used to take up the roles in factories, you know, building tanks and putting ammunition together. Nitram says, "What does I must have used the word hearsay. What does that mean?
Something you've heard from another person, or something that people are saying that has not been necessarily proven. So hearsay is just something you've heard from a friend of a friend of a friend. Someone has said it, but it's not necessarily true, and it's not necessarily proven.
Yes, you could say, "Oh, I've heard such and such has got married, or such and such has been arrested, and you know they were involved in a crime," but you can't prove it. So you say, "Well, that's just hearsay," almost like gossip, almost, isn't it?
Hearsay is something you've heard. It may or may not be true.
But you need to get some more facts to determine whether it
hearsay.
Is. It's something that somebody says that, yeah, you've heard it, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's fact. Right.
We are going in a moment because we have gone, wow, look at that. It is 4:14.
We've packed a lot into today, Mr.
We
Duncan.
We have packed so much into such a tiny space.
It's not quite word of mouth, Victoria. It's not quite word of mouth is something that's passed on and not written down. Word of mouth, that could be a fact. See, if you pass on information to somebody by word of mouth, are you just saying it to somebody else and then they repeat it? That could be a fact.
Yes.
But hearsay is something that you've heard. And it's not necessarily you're almost disparaging what that person's saying. Somebody might say something to you and you might say, "Well, is that true or is it just hearsay?" You know, is Jackie and Johnny I've heard they're having an affair, you know, at work.
Jackie and Johnny.
Okay, then
Jackie and Johnny should never have an affair, because when you say Jackie and Johnny, it sounds silly.
Well, okay, so, Miriam and Gareth.
That sounds weird.
Oh, I've heard that Miriam and Gareth are having an affair. But you'd say, "But is that true or is it just hearsay?" In other words, have lots of people said it and it might not be true.
Word of mouth is something already known to be true quite often. Maybe a product, a service, something that you've heard about, something that actually does exist. Word of mouth is... Well, I suppose it's the oldest form of advertising.
Yes, the oldest form of repeating information. Yes. Just because, of course, before you could write it down. It's 8:45 in India, says Rajendra Singh. Look at that. You're off to bed. You'll be off to bed soon.
Yeah.
Right. It was a pleasure to be here.
I hope you're keeping cool.
Yes.
I hope you're staying cool, because I know the temperature at the moment in India is pretty high. It's hot. 46, I think it was yesterday. 46!
And it's only, you know, it's not even June yet.
It's like the equivalent of spring in India. So you haven't even had summer yet. And it's already 47 degrees, 46 degrees. That's hot. Okay. So I hope you're staying cool.
Lovely to be here and see you all again next week. I hope you all have a lovely week. And Mr. Duncan will be here on Wednesday, is that correct?
I will be back on Wednesday with just me on my own.
Lovely. I shall go and put the kettle on for our cup of tea.
Yes.
Maybe watch a little bit of Columbo. And I need to fill in some holes outside in a wall.
Steve
where
has...
the mortar has fallen out.
Okay. Steve has a manhole that needs filling.
I'm going to do some manual work outside.
But how long will it take you?
Hour. I've got to mix the sand and cement up, and then I've got to push it into the cracks with my trowel. And it's an ideal time to do it because it's quite damp outside.
So it's going to take you maybe a couple of hours with your man.
1 hour.
Yes, I'm just trying to... God. So your man hours is the time. The man power is what you will be doing to carry out the job.
See you all next week. Have a happy week. And, you know, if you're feeling down, we hope we've cheered you up today. And,
or the opposite. If you were feeling cheerful and we've depressed you,
then we apologise.
Sorry about that.
Bye for now.
Oh, don't forget next week, by the way. Next week it is English Addict episode 200.
Are we going to celebrate?
I don't know. Probably not.
Fireworks, a cake, maybe.
Yes. What about fireworks?
I'm trying to go, Mr. Duncan.
What about fireworks inside a cake?
Well. Bye.
Is anyone else doing this? Does anyone else come on the internet on a Sunday and spend 2 hours and 20 minutes with you? Does anyone else do that? I don't think so. I don't think they do. I don't think they do. Only here, every Sunday, we spend a lot of time keeping you company, and I hope you've enjoyed today's live stream. It's almost time for me to say goodbye, but don't worry, I will be back with you on Wednesday. We are back live on Wednesday from 2 p.m. UK time, and I will see you then. Thanks for your company. Thanks for everything that you have contributed today in the live chat. Thank you also for your live donations as well. I will put the address of my PayPal. If you want to make a donation, by the way, to my PayPal, you can, because I do all of this for free. So for the past 2 hours and 20 minutes, I've been doing this for free, 100%. But if you want to make a donation, the address is coming up at the end. Thanks for watching. See you on Sunday. Enjoy the rest of your Wednesday. Sorry. See you on Wednesday. I'm here on Wednesday. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. Enjoy the rest of your May Day. And I will see you on Wednesday. And of course, until the next time we meet here, you know what's coming next. Yes, you do. Ta-ta for now.